So I want to thank everyone for attending. I'm Tina Tidmore. I'm the contracted communications consultant for Pandora.org. And later you're going to find out why we felt it was appropriate for us to do a tribute to the advocacy father, Tom Hennessy, Jr. At this time, you all are on mute except Michelle, Lori, and me, so that we can have an enjoyable listening experience and not have those distracting noises. We do have some planned speakers, and we hope to, we will be having some time for all of you if you would like to give some comments. We are attempting to record this, but we will decide later after we hear how the quality is, whether we'll be releasing it to the public. But you should know that then this is a public meeting. This is an open meeting. Anything here, when it is said here, you should think of it as being said to the whole world. We may have news media listening. We may have family listening, childhood friends, business associates, in addition to many patients. So although this is a memorial, we had realized that actually it would have been better to say this would be a tribute to Tom's life and the tremendous impact that he's had on illness advocacy and also the impact he's had on individuals. So in honor of Tom and his personality and his privacy and showing respect for his family and friends and his memory, we're going to be focusing on his life, his whole life, and not the circumstances of his death. So our planned program is for an hour, and at any time if you need to leave and go take care of something or if you just can't hold out, you can leave and you can come back. You should not feel obliged to stay the whole time. After the hour, we're going to open up the lines again for more sharing amongst ourselves. Many people know Tom only after he became severely ill. I came to know him a couple of times we had spoken by phone, but I mostly knew him as the guy who wrote those long emails and didn't understand the concept of paragraphs. And we know that's probably how many of you came to know of him. We also know he liked to use the caps lock key. But what's also interesting is he liked to sign his messages with an X and an O. So in preparing this for you, though, I got to know a lot about who Tom was at the core, the true Tom underneath the illness, and how his personality and his experience influenced what he did after he became sick. And that's the Tom Hennessy we want to pay tribute today, to today. And so we want to make sure that all of the patients of today and those that got to know him after he was sick understand and know about the disease advocacy heritage. And Tom's work was a major presence in that heritage, and it needs to be passed on. So we hope that the tribute today will accomplish that. Rather than describe Tom from our perspective, we think Tom did a pretty good job of describing himself. We found a message on his Twitter account where he told someone named Young Romeo, "I am 95% work and 5% play. But since my work involves fast transportation, cars, boats, and planes, my second line of work is music of all kinds, but only the best. My favorite is jazz. Then it's women, really, really fine women. Then travel, then food and wine." So in honor of what he loved, and with the help of Wilhelmina and a couple of his other friends, we chose some music to start off this memorial in a way that we think that he would appreciate.
Olha que coisa mais linda, mais cheia de graça, bela menina que vem e que passa, doce balanço, caminho do mar. Moça do corpo dourado, do sol de Ipanema. um poema é a coisa mais linda que eu já vi passar. Ah, por que estou tão sozinho? Ah, por que tudo é tão triste? Beleza que existe, a beleza que não é só minha, que também passa sozinha. Ah, se ela soubesse que quando ela passa, o mundo sorrindo se enche de graça e fica mais lindo por causa do amor.
Joby version of The Girl from Ipanema. As he said, Tom loved jazz and pretty women, but he also loved Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. His cover photo on his Facebook page is a beautiful picture of Rio de Janeiro. We're going to be showing pictures on the Tom Hennessy Phone-In Memorial Facebook page. If you Google Tom Hennessy Phone-In Memorial, you'll find it. It's a Facebook memorial event page. And we'll be posting photos during the memorial service. So this will give you something to look at. If you go to the page now, you can see that picture of Rio de Janeiro. Also, if you have any questions during our tribute, please go to that page and post them there, and Lori will try to help you with that. He posted that photo of Rio de Janeiro on June 20th on his Facebook page. It was the last post he made before he died. We're going to skip now and look back at Tom's childhood. Tom was born in Scranton, Pennsylvania. And you should be able to see a picture of him as a toddler on the Facebook page in the memorial, the Facebook memorial page. It appears he's being held there by his grandfather. He was the firstborn of seven children, he said. Also, you can see a picture of him as a little boy in a cowboy hat. At some point, Tom was in New York, and then by high school, he was in Japan. His nickname was Chauncey, and he kept that nickname and made it part of his Twitter handle even up to the time of his death. The meaning of the word Chauncey is a person who tends to be more talented, smarter, and better overall in numerous ways than the average person. They tend to be deserving of reverence and are thought of highly, but sometimes, due to this, are envied. Since he had that nickname in his high school days, clearly he made an impression on his classmates. One of these is Tomio Kikuchi. Tomio sent us some photos from the annual of St. Mary International High School. And Michelle should be posting those photos on the Tom Hennessy Phone-In Memorial Facebook event page now. Tamia gave us a message that we would like to read to you now. I personally have been suffering from chronic pain for the last 4 or 5 years, and just when I was ready to give up, Tom used to say, Tamia, I've been in pain for the last 25 years or so. And Tomio goes on to say, I am still alive and owe my life to my good old friend, Tom Chauncey Hennessy. We also noticed that he was in the stage band, played basketball, and was in drama. He showed leadership qualities then, serving at some point as the vice president of the student council and then as the president. Michelle, are you able to get those photos on that page?
Yes.
Great. We're going to go on now to talk about his girls. And we have to mention that because in the annual, it, in addition to talking about his church activities, the annual mentioned that he was an avid girl chaser. Tom continued his girl chasing for his whole life. And Michelle is posting on the Facebook Phone-In Memorial page some of the women he loved. We should mention a few of the women particularly. He described Linda Pearl as his high school sweetheart, and he said he should have married her.
Yeah.
You can see a picture of them when they were young on the Facebook memorial page. And then you can see a later picture, we think it's of 2008, of him and her together. She has become a famous actress and a jazz singer. Also, we should mention Cheryl Lynn Kavanaugh Sorensen. Tom described her as his longest-term girlfriend who, quote, took in this poor wanderer at the age of 24 and stayed until we were 29. We will have a picture of her on the Facebook memorial page of her with her daughter. Tom, the perpetual bachelor, said the same of her as he did of some of his other girlfriends. Quote, "When I didn't produce the ring, she kicked me to the curb." In a Facebook post, he said, quote, "I should never have let her get away. Wherever you are, Cheryl, I will always love you, and I apologize for being stupid." When we were planning this tribute, we worried that even though we tried, we did not have a man in our planned speakers. But then when we talked about it, we realized that Tom would love to have a group of women giving him attention and telling his story. And this gave us a good laugh. So now we'd like to tell you briefly about Tom's professional work. He said that he wrote commercials and marketing programs for Fortune 500 companies by day and produced jazz concerts and charity musical events on weekends and at nights. His LinkedIn account said that he worked for Marriott Hotels and Resorts from 1978 to 81. His skills were marketing, promotional events, and public relations. Tom stayed in touch with Bob Goldstein, who he described as a hotel and real estate magnate, a competitor for 3 years, and a business partner for 32 years. You can see a picture of them together on the Facebook phone-in memorial event page. It looks like they're even wearing the same shirt. We also posted an earlier picture of Tom and the 5-year-old Max Goldstein and a dog named Boomer. Tom said Max Goldstein was his godson. And Tom posted that photo on his Facebook often. It was clearly a wonderful memory for him. We're also showing a picture of one of the bands that Tom worked with when he was young. And you can see him in that picture behind the saxophone player. Some of the musicians he was friends with or that he worked with were Rick Jackson and saxophone player Kirk Whalum. We understand that Tom kept in touch with Kirk Whalum up to the time he died. As Tom said, another one of his loves was cars, particularly fast cars. We are posting on the Tom Hennessy Phone-In Event Memorial Facebook page some pictures that Tom had posted on his page of some of the cars he liked. And we noticed that most of them are Ferraris. But there's one of a white BMW, and of that one, Tom said, quote, "Audubon, here we come. This thing will pass anything but a gas station." And, of course, in that we see Tom's strong wit. Just like his youth, Tom's young adulthood included traveling and living in many states. He said, quote, "I've been lucky enough to travel 50 different countries and 47 states." Now we'd like to tell you about Tom becoming ill. Tom said he received flea bites all over his body one day while a senior in college. It was a difficult recovery. 3 years later, he started having problems of lack of blood in the brain, and he would have to lie down twice a day putting his feet up. He said he collapsed in 1984. We figure he would have been 30 at that time. But then he avoided alcohol and he got some treatments, which he said made him feel the best he had ever felt. So he moved to California and he worked in a BMW consultation business, he said. That time he said he was working long hours and 6 days a week. He said that one night he went out drinking and eating raw oysters with a guy that owed him money. Tom said that the next morning he was unable to get out of bed and never worked an 8-hour day again. He was sick with ME. Later, he discovered he also had Lyme disease. And that's when he started his new career as a rabble-rousing advocate. Tom brought his marketing and public relations talent to advocating for these diseases. He called them complex immunological and neurological diseases. And in 1992, he started a May 12th Awareness Day for them. In addition to ME, which was called CFS, also fibromyalgia and Lyme, he also included Gulf War illness. He quoted Louis Pasteur, quote, "The antigen is nothing, the terrain is everything." Tom said of these illnesses that they are different insults, but the same result. Tom pushed for a grouping of these diseases, and it led him to disagreements with some patients, some government leaders, and doctors. But he knew the advocacy for these much maligned illnesses that have similar symptoms needed to be combined so that more can be accomplished and the stigma would be lessened. And while he's never said that they are the same disease, he did say they are similar and should be studied together or side by side. Of course, we now know that there are some differences in these diseases, but also many biological similarity. Due to Tom's fiery words in public and particularly at CFS conference, at a CFS conference in 1998, he ended up being a news media magnate and speaking on Larry King Live and many other television shows about the changes needed in the way the CDC and the NIH handled these diseases. And Tom did make a lot of progress. We'd like to invite Megan Morning Shannon to speak because she was an advocate with him. Megan, if you are on the line with us, please press *61 so that I can unmute you. When we called around to ask who would be the best person to speak about those earlier times, we were told that Megan Morning Shannon was the best one. Megan, can you hear me? All right. Megan, if you can hear me, please press *61 and we'll come back to you. One of the organizations that was, the organization that Tom started was RESCEND, and that stands for Repeal Existing Stereotypes of Complex Immunological and Neurological Diseases. And you can see the logo on the Tom Hennessy Phone-In Memorial Facebook event page. And now we're going to listen while Pandora.org Vice President Michelle Crisco reads some of the comments from Jerry. Michelle?
Yes.
Great. Michelle, can you tell us who Jerry is and what he asked you to read today?
Yes. Good afternoon, everyone. For those of you who do not know, Jerry Grayson was a very, very good friend of Tom's. And they knew each other from the late 1980s. They were both ill with ME. And they had a friendship that grew over the years, not just doing advocacy work, but a real personal friendship. If any of you have ever been on, had been on the RESCEND website in the past and you saw at the bottom where it said, Tom and Jerry, and they had a picture of the two cartoon characters. Well, Jerry is that Jerry. He was, as Tom called him, his partner in crime. Jerry was the webmaster for RESCEND for many years. Jerry really regrets that he couldn't be here today. It is his mother's 89th birthday, and like he said, you know, losing such a dear friend makes the opportunity to be with his living mother all that more sweet. So he did ask me just to relate a couple things on his behalf. I hope I do him justice. Besides advocacy, Tom and Jerry, what they really bonded over was their love of music. And they both loved all kinds of music. But Jerry liked to tease Tom that Tom really liked, quote-unquote, overproduced commercial jazz, while Jerry loved, quote-unquote, good music. So they would jab at each other over music. But they also had a love of playing instruments. And Tom played the saxophone, but Tom wanted to play guitar. And knowing that Jerry played the guitar, he asked him for help in choosing a guitar that would be easy on his hands, because with ME, your muscles tend to tire easily. So Jerry and him started talking about guitars and went into depth into it. To the point of boredom, really, after I read it. But they loved it. And Tom, who had been a world traveler, he wanted a Japanese-style guitar. But Jerry was really into American and felt American was the best. But Tom Jerry helped Tom search for just the right Japanese guitar, which is called a jazz box. And it took 18 months, but finally Tom became a proud owner of a Japanese jazz box guitar. There was always a lot of ribbing between the two of them over which one was the best. And Jerry, thinking he'd get the last word in on one time, surprised Tom and sent him an American amplifier to play with his Japanese guitar. And he had thought that was just the best gift that he could ever have given him. But Tom, not to be outdone, surprised Jerry by giving him a beautiful model boat, a 1950s 52-foot Chris Craft that was assembled sometime in the 50s. It was the perfect gift for Jerry, who also has a passion for boats. A few years later, Tom, knowing Jerry himself was now interested in attaining a Japanese jazz box guitar, conspired with Jerry's wife to buy him one. Tom bought him such a beautiful Ibanez guitar that Jerry cherished it and didn't want to play on it and really beat up on it. So he bought himself a cheaper one to beat up on and has saved the Ibanez that Tom bought him. It was a very cherished gift. As Jerry said, thanks to Tom, I have two beautiful guitars and a gorgeous handmade Chris Craft yacht sitting in a display case in my living room where they will remain and be a reminder of the many years of a wonderful friendship and a friend who will be forever deeply missed.
Thank you, Michelle. Now, about the May 12th awareness that Tom came up with the idea, he said on his Twitter account, "We started this little shindig 22 years ago in Greenwich, Connecticut with a group of sick nurses. May 12th was chosen because of the good weather and because it was the birth date of Florence Nightingale, who had a chronic disabling disease that would today be diagnosed as ME/CFS or fibromyalgia or Lyme disease. Also, ME appears to have a higher prevalence among nurses than other professionals, except in areas of outbreaks, and of course some outbreaks did happen in hospitals where nurses were mostly affected. When Tom would urge others to participate in the May 12th awareness events, he would say, the life you save may be your own. And now we're going to hear from Joni Comstock. Joni, would you mind pressing *61 so that I can unmute you? Joni has taken up the May 12th awareness activities for around the world, and Joni?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us here this afternoon. A special thank you to Pandora Inc. and Tina Tidmore for handling the arrangements for today, everyone else involved, and Creta Pirelli for helping me to convey my thoughts on paper for this tribute. We are gathered here in remembrance of Thomas Hennessy, Jr., who was a wonderful human being and the most valuable player from the start in raising awareness of ME, CFS, FMS, GWS, and Lyme disease. All of these chronic illnesses that mysteriously sprung up in the media and medicine around the same time in the 1980s. Thomas was one of the very first to connect the dots between them all, seeing them as mere symptoms of a much bigger picture, stealth pathogens. You see, Thomas had a vested interest in these syndromes because, once a highly successful PR and marketing professional, he got the wind knocked out of his sails by these syndromes at the height of his career. Words aren't nearly enough to describe our leader, a fierce warrior, advocate, activist, friend, and supporter. Thomas is the creator of the annual International Awareness Day, which is held on the weekend of May 12th in recognition of all those who suffer from complex immunological and neurological diseases. For this alone, he shall always be greatly appreciated and fondly remembered. Thomas Hennessy, Jr. was the founder of Rescind, Inc., repeal existing stereotypes of chronic immunological and neurological diseases. He gave a quarter of a century of his life for this important cause. I am so blessed to have had the honor of knowing him and to call him my dear friend. But he was so much more. He was my hero, mentor, comrade, confidant. He is loved and missed so very much. He fought tirelessly, doing everything to help raise awareness and give wholeheartedly to so many sufferers. Thomas was right early and often when putting together the pieces of this puzzle that of these intertwined debilitating illnesses represent. Our journey began about 4 years ago via Facebook, and we started regular correspondence. He would tell me that I had nothing to gain by lying down when ill. I had been operating my beauty salon in the lower level of my home for 7.5 years while trying to take care of my two kids, but growing more ill with few answers or help from the medical community. When I first met him, my diagnosis was fibromyalgia, just like so many of us are labeled, when all along it was much more. Thomas was a catalyst in helping me get to the bottom of my declining health. My story is very similar to so many of your stories. Along with the fibromyalgia diagnosis, it seemed that my entire body was breaking down. I had multiple different diagnoses, and then came the CFS diagnosis. And then later, the real underlying cause was revealed, Lyme disease and co-infections. Thomas and I worked closely for the past 3 years, and he risked his life to come to my home in Iowa in December 2011 to pick me up, and then we drove back in my 1995 Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme. It's not a Ferrari, but it ran like a champ anyway. We went to his home in Boca Raton, Florida, so that we could work on the 20th anniversary for the International Awareness Day campaign together. During our road trip, we shared so many meaningful experiences. We were fortunate to catch the last tour at Graceland in Memphis, Tennessee. It was like a dream touring Elvis Presley's mansion. We had so much fun on that trip, seeing various sites, taking photos, enjoying each other's company. But we were both chronically ill and had to rest frequently. But Thomas was my inspiration to get up, get out, and do something about our plight. Next, Thomas teamed up with and supported May12.org to carry on his vision. Unite to win this fight together, strength in numbers. Thomas left us with some big shoes to fill, and it will take an army, all of us, to complete his work that he carried out for a quarter of a century while being so sick and debilitated himself. After giving it much thought, I decided he'd want me to speak to you today with a sense of urgency, authoritative undertones, and even a few colorful cuss words. That's our Thomas. He would say, "We don't have time to play nice. Lives are at stake." And because he was not the kind of person to only think of himself, oftentimes he would state that he knew the great toll that those of us stricken were paying, saying, "I worry about the health of all the good warriors out there in our search for the truth." Thomas knew that the syndrome or labels that most of us are diagnosed with are a cover-up, watering down the real truth, the reality of what we are really dealing with, stealth pathogens. chronic fatigue syndrome, Gulf War syndrome, fibromyalgia, Lyme disease, and other neuroimmune endocrine diseases. These disease labels are in reality a cover-up of a much bigger picture involving germ warfare, bioweapons, Plum Island, and so on. Thomas knew this all too well, and he continually conveyed this message to any and all who would listen, even taking this message to the Larry King show twice in the late 80s, early 90s, a major event that Thomas spoke of often. You could tell that he was very proud of this particular moment in his lifetime of activism. Read Lab 257 by Michael Christopher Carroll. Thomas would repeatedly tell people. He was especially fond of that book and referred to it often. Thomas also spent a lot of his time trying to get the legal system involved in our plight. He was working on a dream team for a class action lawsuit to end this nightmare once and for all. Willie Gary, also known as the Giant Killer, Joe Jamal, hell, add in Aaron Brockovich, he would say. Thomas dreamed of benefit concerts similar to Farm Aid to raise funds via the nonprofit organization that he founded, Rescind, Inc. He knew that we needed well-known artists to step up like they did for AIDS. In the spirit of Thomas's endless, tireless efforts, we demand that the misnomer of chronic fatigue syndrome be changed to myalgic encephalomyelitis, just as used in other parts of the world. This issue was of the utmost importance to Thomas, as many of you may know. We demand the complete removal of CFS from all medical literature. We demand that the proper names and ICD, International Classification of Diseases codes, are incorporated into the medical and insurance blue books in all emergency rooms, medical centers, and physicians' offices throughout the world. We demand, until more is understood about our diseases and better treatment, cures, and preventatives are available, that these horrifically painful diseases are treated with the best compassionate care that is needed for survival, let alone some semblance of quality of life, just like we see with every other disease. We demand medical and insurance coverage. We demand listings from the Social Security Administration for all our diseases and SSA disability approval. We demand that the research into these conditions is finally steered in the correct direction. We've already lost over three decades to funding of research in the wrong directions, all to confuse the issue and cover it up. We demand acknowledgement that all of these diseases from which we are suffering are being caused by the same things, stealth pathogens that our current medical community remains, for the most part, completely clueless about, thanks to complete denial from our own government. We demand a swift end to this seemingly endless suffering so that no more lives are lost. How many more must suffer from these wretched diseases without support from the medical professionals, insurance companies, and even our own government? We lose our friends, families, careers, homes, virtually everything, all stripped away, all because we have a government that could not care less about us, about their lives, about righting these offensive wrongs. Are we angry? Hell yes, we are, and so is Thomas. We are angry at the lack of any action whatsoever regarding these brutal, disabling illnesses over the past three decades. There's still so much ignorance and denial and an extreme amount of suffering so many of us are going through due to these complex diseases. Enough is enough. No more. It's time for the Infectious Diseases Society of America, the Center for Disease Control, the National Institutes of Health, and Yale University to be held directly accountable for the deliberate suffering and torture of millions around the globe. Thomas would really love that. We're angry about so very much. How could that be? How could we not be? How can we just sit back and let the medical community and our government continue to nail the coffin shut on us while we are still slightly alive or barely there? How can this be allowed to continue? Where's the humanity in that? We've been robbed, and they continue to get away with murder. Unacceptable. And right now, we are extremely angry, yet full of sadness, because we have lost our Thomas, a brilliant, eclectic man who remained ever dedicated to his mission, a true friend and warrior. We were robbed. At last, it's just that pain, that ever-present, all-encompassing pain, eventually overtakes the thought processes, all logic, empathy, and many other human emotions that tie us to others. We were robbed. It then becomes its own living, breathing entity with 24/7 emotional, physical, and mental pain. We were robbed of our Thomas. When going through these tough times, a good support system is absolutely necessary. Please reach out. Thomas would want that, as he cared for so much about each and every one of us. Thomas told me and many others out there, always take care of you first, numero uno. Thank you, Thomas, for your dedication and all your hard work. And as we would end most of our conversations, God bless.
Thank you, Joni. We know that Tom stayed in touch with many patients. He was said in 2012 that he would receive 300 emails each day. We tried to get to all of his friends to invite them to the tribute, but there were so many, we're sure we missed some. And yes, he argued with some patients, both privately and publicly, and with doctors and government officials. But as for the patients and his friends, even though he had disagreements, he remained close and loyal to his friends, and despite sometimes having strong disagreements. Tom also became friends with the well-known researcher Judy Mikovits. Judy, if you were there, please press *69 so that you can give your comment, just a few minutes of your comment. I'm sorry, *61. Judy, if you're there, please speak. Please press *61. Judy Mikovits is now available to speak. Judy, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here, Tina.
Great. Can you take just a couple of minutes?
Can
We're running kind of short, but we'd love to hear what you have to say because we know you and Tom got to be friends.
Yes. Tom and I had some wonderful correspondences, and we met finally in last January at the Physicians Roundtable in Tampa, Florida. So he continued to encourage me to fight the fight, and I agreed with him that we were on the same wavelength in where we were going. So on November 26th of 2012, before I got to the physician roundtable, I answered him in an email and said, "Hey TMH, happy holidays. So nice to hear from you. Sorry for the long silence. I had to secure some email and networks. I'm working as an independent consultant to cure all of these diseases. It is about the truth and you and nothing else. Never has been and never will be in my world. There are a lot of people who know the truth and are helping us. I'll be there in Tampa in January. See you there." And he wrote back, "So glad to hear from you. I've been trying to message you. On the disease front, I've claimed for 25 years that all of these disorders were cases of a different insult with the same result. I believe they can be triggered by viruses, bacteria, or chemical toxic agents. We are on the same page. They often happen to the more fair skin of our population, but all nation, all nationalities, and all ethnic groups. We are generally an ambitious bunch." So he says, "What can I say? It is our brains, not in our minds. I have urged you for close to 4 years to read that book." I'll read it someday. I know I will. "By totally independent research, I have received tips from top Navy SEALs and troops who went in to get Osama bin Laden, orders of the president. You will also find, and if you Google the so-called Lyme disease, people like me who got bitten by fleas in September of 75, as we heard. So we've learned to, I spent a long time with Tom in January talking about all our common interests. We totally and completely agree about the insults and the immune dysfunction, and that this is a disease that the government is fully aware of and should be fully aware of, and knows that we meaning all of us, the patient community and the scientific community, have worked so hard, are not going to give up. He says, so glad to hear back from you. I did put your photo up toasting with some margaritas with your husband and Ms. Lily Meehan. I totally plan to spend the weekend with you in January. Stay safe until then. He did spend that weekend with me in January, and we had just a lovely time with Joni and looking at all of this and discussing his plan to raise a big fundraiser, which was supposed to be this sometime this year. He wrote to me last, right after the meeting, and said, so happy to see you there. Thanks so much for coming to the conference last week, and thanks Sue Vogan for putting together such a panel of experts. And so he said, hopefully next year we can work on putting that concert together. If you have not yet read the Lab 257, the true story of so-called Lyme disease, which I promise I will read. I will do it someday. He gives me the XO of TMH, and I write him back and tell him it was all my pleasure. He uses the word QL. He says JM, which is always JAM with me. I never sign anything just JM because there are so many J. Mikovitzes around the world, some of whom I will meet tomorrow. He says, glad to hear they didn't get to you. I figured you were tougher than they were. So I'll just tell him we are both tougher, and we will stay tougher. And I know for sure he is an angel in heaven looking out for all of us. So we'll stay safe and keep plugging along.
Thank you, Judy. Now we're going to hear from Lori Chapo Kroger, the president of Pandora Org. Lori, you should be unmuted, and we should be able to hear you. Lori?
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, we'd like to hear you now.
Okay, hello, everybody. Like many of you, I also had a personal relationship with Tom. And some of you might not realize this, but the former president of Pandora, Marley Silverman, helped Tom a lot. They both lived in Boca Raton, Florida. And the last message that I got from Tom, he said, Marley has literally saved my life, and saved is in all caps. And also our organization embraced his idea to advocate for the group of the diseases. And so we have followed Tom's lead in that. And his last email communication with him, he wrote to me, Pandora is almost a carbon copy of Rescind Inc. And this is why we felt we should host this tribute to his life and his advocacy work. We are working to get these diseases covered in a new medical specialty, and also to create clinical care centers for these diseases as a whole group. I have a few funny stories that I'd like to share about Tom. He used to tell me that when he was watching the Chronic Fatigue Syndrome Advisory Committee meetings, that he would be pitching a fit in his small room. And if you know Tom, I'm sure you can only imagine what that would look like. And just in recent years, just a couple of years ago, he called in to give testimony to the committee, and the person who was controlling the phones, of course, was Dr. Wanda Jones. And true to his personality, Tom made a remark about her pretty new hairdo that made her really blush, and that made many of the SysVac members and patients laugh. He was really good for a girl's ego, including mine. We did notify Dr. Jones of his death, and she remembered that remark, even though it was years ago. And as we all know, he certainly is memorable. Tom had a way of combining humor, flirting, and wit with confrontational and shocking words, and he spoke truth to power. He told me that one time when he was debating something with someone, that they said to him he had an alligator's mouth and a tadpole's ass. I just thought that was really funny. It meant a lot to me when he told me that he was glad I was the new president of Pandora Org after Marley retired, and I certainly learned a lot from Tom's example. One of the things that we do is provide support for patients directly, just as Marley did for Tom. Often that is an encouragement. We know that the Internet has created a community of patients where we can support each other, and that's a great thing. But it also means that we get more news, both good and bad. And in the last few years, unfortunately, we have seen quite a few patients we know through Facebook or even through message boards that have died unexpectedly. And this can make some patients really sad and frustrated and feel hopeless. And if you ever feel that way, I hope and I encourage you to reach out to me. My phone number is on Pandora Org's website. You can reach out to fellow patients online, or if your family members are supportive, reach out to them. It's just important that you reach out to somebody. We also have spoken with the president of an organization called Kristen Brooks Hope Center. They are a crisis hotline, and they often get calls from people with serious diseases like ours. In fact, the president has some personal experience with these diseases. And he said if any one of our patients feel hopeless, to please call them at 800-442-HOPE. Again, it's 800-442-HOPE. We are putting that number on Tom Hennessy Jr.'s Phone-In Memorial Facebook page and on our website, and it will be on the news page. You can also talk to a trained volunteer through their internet chat service, and that website is hopeline.com, hopeline.com. And the president of the company also said that if any of the patients with these diseases would like to help, they can become a trained volunteer to answer the phones. The time involved can be as little as 1 4-hour session a week if you want to volunteer. And who knows, you might even end up helping another patient with a neuroendocrine immune disease. For years, despite a severe car accident that increased his pain and his continuous struggle with the other symptoms of the disease he had, Tom was trying to put together a benefit concert in honor of Ruth Brinker. And she's a woman who provided food for him for 2 years when he was very sick in California. You can see a picture of her on the Tom Hennessy Phone-In Memorial Facebook page. And Tom said Grammy-winning music producer Phil Ramone was supposed to help him pull this all together. But unfortunately, Mr. Ramone died in March of this year, and so that made the goal unattainable. Quite a few of Tom's friends told us that he had chosen a particular song to end that concert. That popular song has been sung by many performers, but after considering them all, he finally decided he preferred Eva Cassidy's version to end the concert. And we would like to play that for you right now.
Ah.
Again, if you feel that you need some hope, we're going to ask you to call the Pandora Org phone number that is on the Pandora Org website, or call 800-442-HOPE. And at one point, we had 90 people who were on the phone call with us. At this point, we have 83. We want to thank you all for joining us in honoring the father of May 12th, Sins Awareness Disease Advocacy Day, which is complex immunological and neurological disease. The great Tom Hennessy, Jr.